in this section, we would like to talk about adding and subtracting square roots. Now here's the deal. You can only add or subtract square roots that have like radicands. So remember this symbol, the square root part, that's called a radical, and the stuff underneath, the 3 in this case, is called the radicand. And the only way you can add or subtract is if they have like radicands. So you work with the numbers in the front. So this first problem really compares to doing this, something like 5x minus 7x. It's like terms. So the 5 is like is the coefficient of x, and the 7 negative is the coefficient of x here, and that would give you negative 2x. Well, same story, okay? We've got 5 square root of 3 minus 7 square root of 3. That's going to give me negative 2 square root of 3. So I want you to keep in mind that those radicals, the square root, and the number underneath must match. So if one's a square root and one's a cube root, you can't do this. Or if one's a 3 and one's a 4, you can't do this. Both of those things have to match. So I'm looking at the next problem. Notice they're both a square root of u, and I'm adding, which means you add the coefficients in front. I'm adding 5 plus 3. That gives me 8, and you keep the common square root of u. Now look at this next problem. I've got a square root of a and a square root of b. Those are not like radicands. So what do you do? Nothing. This is completely simplified. You can't do anything else with that. Now look at this one. I've got a square root of 10, a square root of 10, and a square root of 10. Okay, so I do have like radicals and radicands. So I'm working with the coefficients in front. If it helps you to see this better, I've got a 6, a 2, and a 3. I combine those together. 6 plus 2 is 8, 8 plus 3 is 11, and I keep the like term there, square root of 10. Well, let's keep going. So notice in example E, I've got a 3 square root of 7 and an 8 square root of 7 that I'm subtracting, and a 2 square root of 5. Now this guy down here at the end, 2 square root of 5, is not a like radical. So I do 3 subtract 8, that's going to give me negative 5, and I keep the square root of 7 plus 2 square root of 5. And since these are not like radicands or like radicals, I am finished with that problem. Now notice these guys all have square root of 3y. All 3 of these terms are square root of 3y, which means I can work with the coefficients in front. Got a 4, a negative 7, and a positive 2. I combine those together. 4 minus 7 is negative 3. Negative 3 plus 2 is a negative 1 and a square root of 3y. Or you can write that as negative square root of 3y. We notice, you know, when you don't have a number in front, it's an implied 1. Of course, the negative there makes an implied negative 1. Completely simplified doesn't have the 1 there. Next problem, notice these are all square root of 7mn. So I add 3 plus what? Well, remember, just like we mentioned, there's a 1 in front of there. So I'm adding 3 plus 1 is 4. 4 minus 4 is 0. Let's think about that. So again, 3 plus 1, 4. 4 minus 4 is 0. Square root of 7mn. Well, 0 is just 0, right? 0 times square root of 7mn is 0. So the simplified version of that is 0. Now check this last one out. Square root of 27 and 4 square root of 3. Those are not like radicals, so I just dismiss it and move on. Well, remember, we've got one more issue that both of these are square roots. One of them can be simplified. The square root of 27, if you go down your list of perfect squares, remember our list of perfect squares, 4 is on the list of perfect squares, 3 squared is 9, 4 squared is 16, 5 squared is 25, 6 squared is 36, 7 squared is 49, 8 squared is 64, and keep going. The biggest perfect square that divides into 27 that's on that list is 3. I can rewrite the square root of 27 as 9 times 3, and 4 square root of 3 I'm not doing anything with. The square root of 9 is 3. So that's 3, but this 3 stays underneath the square root plus 4 square root of 3. Now notice they're both square roots of 3 now. So I can add my 3 plus my 4 to get 7 square root of 3. So for a problem like I, we have square root of 20 and square root of 45. Those are not like radicals. So what we need to do is simplify the radicals like we did in the previous section. So I'm going to rewrite square root of 20. Well, first of all, I'm going to bring the 3 down. And rewrite the square root of 20 as a perfect square times whatever it takes to give me 20. The biggest perfect square that divides into 20 is 4, and 4 times 5 gives me 20, minus 7, and the biggest perfect square that divides into 45 is 9, and 9 times 5 is 45. And then what I'm going to do is take the square root of the values I can, like the 4 and the 9. So that's going to be 3, the square root of 4 is 2, that'll multiply times that 3, square root of 5, minus 7 times the square root of 9 is 3, and then it leaves the square root of 5. So notice what I did. The values that were perfect squares, I took the square root of them and they came out. So the square root of 9 and it came out. And when it comes out, it multiplies by anything that's in front. So 3 times 2 gives me 6 square root of 5 minus 21 square root of 5. And 6 subtract 21 gives me negative 15 square root of 5 as my final answer. Now I'll look at example J. And notice they are both the same radical. They are both square root of 3. Okay, so what I really need to do is work with the multiplication that's at front. When I multiply 2/3 times 6, we can imagine that's really 6 over 1. And I can cancel this 6 with this 3, and that leaves 2. 2 times 2 is 4. Over 1 times 1 is 1. So that's just 4 square root of 3. Minus this 7 cancels with that 7, and that's 5 square root of 3. And then 4 subtract 5 gives me negative 1 square root of 3, better written as negative square root of 3. Okay, now K is very similar to J, but the difference is J has like radicals. They're both square root of 3. Example K does not have like radicals. So I need to write 32 as the biggest perfect square that divides into 32 times whatever it takes. So watch this. 2/5, I'm just recopying. The square root of 32 I'm going to write is 16 times 2. Because 16 is the biggest perfect square that divides into 32, and 32 is 16 times 2. Minus 1/3. Now the biggest perfect square that divides into 8 is 4 times 2. Now again, highlighted, I'm going to take the square root of 16 and bring it out front as 4. And I'm going to take the square root of 4 and bring it out front as 2. And I'm going to multiply those fractions together. So that's going to be 2/5 comes down. The square root of 16 is 4, and that leaves square root of 2 underneath. Minus 1/3 comes down. The square root of 4 is 2, and that leaves square root of 2 underneath. Now I'm going to multiply these in front. 2 times 4 is 8. 5 times, there's really a 1 underneath there, 5. Square root of 2 minus 1 times 2 is 2. Thirds, square root of 2. Now the next issue is I can't combine these coefficients together. Even though they're like radicals, square root of 2 and square root of 2, I can't combine them together because I don't have a common denominator. My common denominator is 15, so I'm going to multiply my first fraction, 8/5, times 3 over 3 to make that a 15, and my second fraction times 5 over 5 to make that a 15. So I continue over here to the right. I've got 24 over 15 times the square root of 2 minus 10 over 15 times the square root of 2. Finally, I have like radicals and a common denominator. So I do 24 subtract 10. That gives me 12 over 15 square root of 2. That reduces to 3 goes into both of those, 4/5 square root of 2, and that's my final result. So a lot of work went into that problem. Okay, and then my last problem, 27p to the third, 48p to the third, again, they both have p to the thirds, but they are not like radicals because 27 and 48 are not the same number. So I need to simplify these radicals as much as possible. So I'm going to write 27 as a perfect square times something. I'm even going to write p to the third as a perfect square times something. So 27, the biggest perfect square that goes in there is 9. So 9 times 3 and p to the third, because I can't take half of 3, I need to write it as p squared times p to the first. Minus 48, biggest perfect square that divides in 48 is 16 times 3. And p to the third I'm going to write as p squared times p to the first. Now I'm going to highlight the perfect squares for you so you can see exactly what I'm doing. 9's a perfect square, p squared's a perfect square. 16's a perfect square, p squared's a perfect square. Now what I'm going to do is take the square root of those highlighted values. They do not go under a square root. So the square root of 9 is 3. It comes out. The square root of p squared is p. It comes out of the square root. What remains under the square root is what I don't have highlighted, which is this 3 and this p. So 3p. Minus the square root of 16 is 4. It comes out. The square root of p squared is p. It comes out. What stays underneath is the 3p here. Now I work with, notice they're like radicals now, and not only that, they're like terms because they have exactly the same variable part, and that is required. So if by chance this was a p and this was an x, we could not do what we're about to do. They have to have exactly the same radical and exactly the same variable parts that are in the radical. So I'm working with the numbers in front. The 3 subtract 4 gives me negative 1 square root of 3p, better known as negative square root of 3p, is my final answer there. All right, I got two more problems I want to show you. So notice again, look at the radicals. I'm adding, well, actually I'm subtracting, and they don't match. That means I cannot combine these together. But what I can do is attempt to simplify each of them separately and then see if they match. And in that case, I can take it further if required. So the square root of 48, the biggest value that's a perfect square that divides evenly into 48 is 16. So I'm going to rewrite 16 as 16 times 3 times the y squared that's already there, minus 4. 72 I'm going to write as, now what's the biggest perfect square that divides into 72? I know 9 goes into 72, but that's 9 times 8, and 8 has a perfect square, so how about 36? So 36 times 2 times y squared. Now if I keep going, let me highlight this for you, I'm going to take the square root of the perfect squares. 16 is a perfect square, and y squared is a perfect square. 36 is a perfect square, and y squared is a perfect square. So those things that I can take the square root of, I'm going to move them out front, and I'm going to multiply them times the 7. So I have 7 times the square root of 16 is 4. The square root of y squared is y. Now what stays underneath the square root is the 3 that's not a perfect square, minus the 4 that's already sitting there. The square root of 36 is 6, and the square root of y squared is y. And what stays underneath is that 2 that was already there. Okay, now this gives me 28y square root of 3 minus 4 times 6 is 24y square root of 2. Guess what, folks? We do not have like radicals. That's as good as that problem gets. We simplified, but it didn't do us any good. We still can't combine these things together. I do a quick check and make sure 16 times 3 is 48. That's right, 36 times 2 is 72, so we didn't do it wrong. It happens. So you simplify and you hope for the best, and sometimes you can continue to combine together and sometimes you can't. Let's see if we have any better luck on this one. Now notice they are different radicals right now. So I know I can't combine them together as is. But I can work on each one of these guys separately. So 3 stays in front. Now 18 has a big perfect square that divides into it. It's 2. So I'm going to rewrite 18 as 9 times 2. X squared is underneath there. Okay. I'm going to move on to minus 6x. Square root of 32 has a perfect square that divides into it. It's 16 times 2, okay, plus 2 already in front, and the square root of 50, I'm going to rewrite that as 25 times 2, and then the x squared is underneath there. Now, again, I'm going to highlight the perfect squares underneath these square roots so you can see exactly what I'm going to do next. The 9's a perfect square, the x squared's a perfect square. I'm going to take the square root of each of those and bring it out. The 16's a perfect square, and that's it there. The 25's a perfect square, and the x squared's a perfect square. I'm going to take the square root of those and bring them out front. So that is my next step. So the 3 is already there. The square root of 9 is another 3, and the square root of x squared is x, which leaves 2 underneath the radical. Minus 6x, it's already there. Square root of 16 is 4, and that leaves 2 under the radical. Plus 2, which is out front. The square root of 25 is 5. The square root of x squared is x, and that leaves 2 under the radical. I keep simplifying. That's 9x square root of 2 minus 24x square root of 2 plus 10x square root of 2. Now, check it out. They all have square root of 2s, which is awesome. And they all have x's, so we have like terms here. Now I'm just working with the coefficients, so I'm going to highlight that in aqua. We got a 9, a negative 24, and a plus 10. I'm going to combine those things together. 9 minus 24 is negative 13, right? Yes. Negative 13 plus 10 is negative 3. So the coefficients add to be negative 3. Check it again. 9, we could either do 9 plus 19 minus 24. Did I do that right? No, that's not right. 9 minus 24 is negative 15. My brain's not working right. So that's negative 15 plus 10 is negative 5. Let's get rid of this. Get rid of the evidence. All right. Check it on your calculator. Another way you could do it is 9 plus 10 is 19. 19 minus 24 is negative 5. So it's negative 5 is my coefficient. I keep the variable part, x, and I keep the radical part, square root of 2. That's my final answer there. Hope this helps. If you had trouble with this, you might want to go back a section and check out the previous section on simplifying radicals. If this feels pretty good, you're ready to move on to the next section where we'll be doing something different with radicals.